started, a couple of things that I want you to know. Number one, we are streaming the event, so please be mindful of that. Also, be mindful that we have multiple guests in our building today. Our staff and our students have worked hard to put this presentation together for you. So please use it with your absolute best behavior today. And a special thank you for Ms. Hampton and our students for organizing this event today. And we would like to thank our guests and our speakers for joining us today. We really appreciate that, this opportunity not just to showcase the talents of our students in our school, but to showcase our performing arts facility. And this is a long-standing, for those of you who don't know, this is a long-standing tradition of Baton Rouge Cats. And so this means a lot to a lot of folks here, so please be mindful of that when you're in here today. The assembly will last right at an hour or so, and so we will adjust the fourth period bell schedule just briefly. And as we dismiss, we will dismiss back to the classroom that you came from, and then we will rotate the 4 o'clock, okay? So again, thank you. Our master of ceremony today is Mr. Student Body President, and my turn over to him, Mr. Brandon Meek.
Will everyone please rise for the posting of the colors by Baton Rouge High School Distinguished ROTC program. Remain standing for the second national anthem by Asia Henderson and Maya Price.
Stand the ring.
this time, we have Audrey Jones introducing our first guest speaker.
Tamaya Rivers, businesswoman, mentor, public speaker. From being in prison for 6 years, becoming one of the most successful businesswomen, mentor, and public speaker in the Low Country, Tamaya Rivers has influenced and empowered numerous individuals and families with her powerful testimony. Tamaya Rivers is the CEO of Reconditioned Appliances. She has been featured in top publications such as The State, The Island Packet, and Heart Ministry Radio. Within 1 year of business, Ms. Rivers has already provided hundreds of people in her community with quality, affordable appliances. Her goal is to set an example for adults and youth, proving that no matter your circumstances, you can overcome your obstacles and accomplish what you set your mind to. As a philanthropist, Ms. Rivers has founded the God's Princesses Mentoring Foundation. In her first year, she has taken on the challenge of mentoring 6 students. All of the students enrolled are currently on the honor roll and on our pace for college. She has also held public speaking events to hundreds of children, most recently to the Beaufort Marine Institute, a juvenile facility for at-risk youth. Tamaya Rivers.
Hello, good morning, good afternoon, how are you? Thank you so much for having me here today for Black History Month. The topic, Black migrations, really caused me to think about myself and my life and my own experiences. When my parents came here, all of the slaves came here actually from ports in Savannah and Charleston, where all the slaves came in. Give me a minute, please.
Take your time.
Thank you. Thank you. And I started thinking about my own story, about my family, and how I grew up. And I'm from Beaufort. I'm a native from Beaufort, actually. I grew up right down the street here on County Shed Road. I grew up in a family with a father, a mother, and a sister. And on the outside, it looked like a typical family, but inside, we were far from being typical. My father graduated from high school. My mother got pregnant at 15. I lived with my sister, and I was abused by 2 cousins. My father was an alcoholic and abused my mother often. By the time I was 13, my parents got divorced. We moved in with my great uncle and his family. When we moved there, I felt free. I was free from the hands of watching my father abuse my mother. I was free from my 2 cousins who were sexually abusing me. I was free from watching my mother be abused by my father. By the time I was 15, I started using alcohol. Yeah, that became my drug to cover all the pain that I was feeling internally. By the time I was 16, I had my first boyfriend. He was everything like my father, abusive and very jealous. He wanted to know where I was and when I would be back. By the time I was 21, I was looking for a job. I had no idea who I was or whose I was. I didn't know my skills or my talents, so I took the best job that was available, which was a low salary job. By the time I was 23, I met my boyfriend. He was a drug dealer. This time he was worse than my father. He was a narcissist. Narcissists are people with personality disorders. Yeah, it's real. I stayed in that relationship for 8 years. Yes, 8 years. He made me feel loved. I didn't know who I was or whose I was. And I thought love was all balled up into materialistic things. Cars, jewelry, clothes, houses. I ended up having a son for him. When my son was 3 months old, his father went to federal prison for 30 years. I was sentenced to a 10-year sentence when my son was 3 years old. I left my son. When I went to prison, that was an eye-opener for me. I needed to focus on me. I needed to find who I was and whose I was. I needed to know the capacity of my mind. Not all prisoners are inside a prison. Prison is one of the most expensive slavery plantations you will find today. While I was there, I decided to change the way I thought about myself, the way I thought about life, the way I thought about my circumstances, the way I thought about people. I started investing in myself and in my mind. When I came out of prison, the 3-year-old I left, he was in the 5th grade. I didn't get any help with assistance. No public assistance was there for me. Everything was hard work and a determined spirit, most of all, a made-up mind. I went to TCL, enrolled, and got my accounting certificate, and my associate's degree. I went to Park University and received my bachelor's degree. I'm now enrolled in Park Master's Business Administration to get my master's degree. That son I left, he's 22. He graduated from UNO, University of New Orleans, with a bachelor's in marketing. He now works for Beaufort County as a director of marketing. I now own the company that I started off when I came back from prison. I'm the owner of it. Recondition Appliances. The same community that I hurt with my drug dealer boyfriend, I want to change it. And I'm doing it every day. I sell quality appliances at affordable prices so that every family can deserve to have the appliance that they want for their families. The kitchen is the heart of the family. It's where memories are created. I have a mentoring program, God's Princesses, where I mentor young women, teaching them that they can live their dreams. I have a 10th grader who just got accepted into Yale's summer program. What I learned when I was away, when my parents got divorced, when I lived with my uncle when I was 13, he was a slave from over on the air station. Back then, it wasn't the air station, it was a plantation. And they migrated out into the different areas here in Beaufort. And what I admired the most about him, that I never forgot, even when I was a slave walking around mentally, not knowing who I was, or even knowing my own identity, I still learned something from him. What he did when he was over on the plantation, he still owned his own home. It wasn't too far from his master's, but he had his own home. So when he was free, when the air station bought the plantation, he came over to Burton and he brought his house. But not only did he just bring his house, he brought a free mind with him. He wasn't a slave. He had his own business. He was an entrepreneur right here in this community. He taught me a lot about that. Entrepreneurship is wealth. We need that wealth inside of our communities. We need to support each other who do have businesses. He taught me independence. That's the only way you're gonna have wealth. You have to have your own. Whatever it is, if it's entrepreneurship or a dream, don't give up on your dreams. I didn't give up on mine. I went through a lot of things, challenges, and obstacles in life, but I held on to my faith. So I encourage each and every one of you today, dream. Dream big. If your dream doesn't scare you, it's not big enough. Don't worry about the how. Just dream and do it. I hope my story inspired you. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you so much, Ms. Rivers, for your remarks. And I think that's honestly a beautiful story that we can all learn from. Thank you again. Please now join me in welcoming to the stage Renasia Henderson. Renasia will be singing "I Know Where I've Been."
Yeah. Harkin, is president of the Bowie Heritage Consulting Services. He's a member of the Bowie Cultural Corridor Commission and is considered one of the leading experts on Bowie cultural heritage. His career in historic and environmental preservation in South Carolina and the Georgia Lowcountry spans more than 40 years. He is executive director emeritus, Penn Center, St. Helena Island, South Carolina. Mr. Campbell earned a bachelor's degree in biology from Savannah State College in Savannah, Georgia in 1965 and a master's degree in environmental engineering from Tufts University in Boston, Massachusetts in 1971. He has received numerous honors, including honorary doctorate degrees from Bank Street College in New York and University of South Carolina, New York. Please welcome Mr. Campbell.
Good afternoon. I want to thank Adam for that wonderful introduction. I want to thank you for having me with you. The last time I believe I was at Battery Creek, I had been in the gymnasium. It was a wonderful occasion. You know who was there? Barack Obama. He had just announced that he was going to run for president, and he chose Battery Creek to begin his campaign in South Carolina. And I came to hear him speak. And so I was so proud of Battery Creek that day. The gym was full to the roof, and students were there cheering, and we had a nice choir that performed for him. And this place really impressed me then, and it's impressing me today with all of you being in the auditorium here, listening to hear about Black history. Battery Creek did another thing for me while I was director of Penn Center. We always try to have bands to come in the parade, and we had a hard time getting schools to participate, but Battery Creek always showed up. You know, some of them used to say the creek is weak. The creek is strong now. Always have been, right? So I am honored to be here when one of the most, I think, dedicated educators in the country called and asked me to come. I told her I was too old for young people to listen to, but she said to come anyway. And it's one of your teachers, Ms. Hampton. I think she is one of the greatest teachers, one of the greatest educators around. Give her a hand. Just met your distinguished principal, Mr. Cox. And just by your presence and what I've heard so far, he's a great principal, one of the greatest principals around Beaufort County, maybe in the country. And we're proud, we're pleased and honored to have our school board member with us, one of our school board members, Mr. Tierra. So I thank you and I honor you for taking the time out to observe Black History Month. Black History Month was started way back in 1926, and it was started by a man who had achieved greatly in education. He graduated from Harvard University with a PhD, and other people had been graduating and contributing to the country who looked like him, Black people, but nobody recognized them, nobody knew enough about them. And so he decided that he was gonna start a Black History Week so that people could learn about themselves who were Black, could learn about themselves, and people who were not Black could learn about what Black people had contributed to the world and to the country. And so he set out to ask the country to observe Black History Week. His name was Carter G. Woodson. wrote one of the best books that I've ever read that you should read, called Miseducation of Negroes. In that time, those times we were called Negroes. So read that book, all of you, no matter if you're black or white. You're learning something. And so he has stressed that we know something about ourselves and that others know something about our contribution to the world and to the country. And we have a lot to share with the world. Not only do we have dynamic culture that contributes to music and arts, and you can name them all, it goes right from spirituals and slavery that Ms. Rivers talked about, all the way up to today. And within that, you get spirituals in terms of music and art, all the way up to rap. And all evolve from our ingenuity and creativity. We have great scientists, and despite of the obstacles and the hard times that you may think you have, you look at people who have achieved greatness in education and in the arts and in science, and they've overcome all kinds of obstacles to get there. They didn't have school buses. They may have had to walk to school. They didn't have the money and the finances that you may have. But they thought that the priority should be achieving a good education so they could contribute to the world. You take Ron McNear, who grew up right there in Florence, just outside, a place called Lake City. He became an astronaut. After being denied entrance into a public library because he was black. And he's a pretty young fellow. I mean, he was. But he pioneered, went on to MIT, got his doctorate in mathematics, and became an astronaut. Of course, he was the one that, you know, the Challenger when it exploded, was in that. But you have people like that who overcome great obstacles and achieve. And so Black history is a time for you to reflect on your black brethren and sisters who have achieved greatness through education and other means. And there's no better place to start than Battery Creek. I want to close by saying something about your color culture. How many people here have color? Do you know whether you are? Well, the color culture now is known throughout the world, and we have been lifting it up so that people who are of color background can now become proud of who they are. We are the only ones that still can reflect some of our African origins, the speech, the food, the art, the music, the craft, and of course, the history that can show how we come about. How many of you been to the National Museum in Washington, D.C. on African American history and culture? Well, you're represented there as color people from these islands and from the coast of South Carolina, Georgia, North Carolina, Florida, where we retain so much about our African history and our African way of life, whereas others have pretty much forgotten it or don't even know it. You at Battery Creek, you who grew up in the Beaufort County area, or who even have come here and lived, going to be asked about color culture when you go to college, when you leave here and migrate throughout the country. They're going to ask you, what about color? Can you speak any? What do you all do for music? Where did the music come from? What about your food? Do you like rice? Do you like watermelon? Do you like sweet potatoes? Do you like over? And aspects of color culture, food ways, spiritual life, art, is what you learn when you migrate. This year's theme that Dr. Carter's organization called the Association for the Study of African American Life and History. They come up with a theme every year. This year's theme is Black Migrations. And as you migrate away from this area throughout the country, people are going to be asking you about yourself. And you must know about yourself in order to know about others. So that you can help teach others about yourself, you must know about yourself. And so I leave you with the thought that you must know yourself and know where you're going before you know anybody else or before you know how to get where you're going. So I thank you for this opportunity to be with you, and I wish you well for the rest of the season.
Thank you again, Mr. Campbell, for your motivating words. Now our dancers will entertain us with an abridged reading of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s I Had a Dream speech.
Children will be able to sing in unity.
My father.
And if America is to be a great nation, this must become true. Let freedom ring from the prodigious hilltops of New Hampshire.
Let freedom ring from the mighty mountains of New York. Let freedom ring from the high mountains of Pennsylvania.
Let freedom ring from the snow-capped Rockies of Colorado. Let freedom ring from the curvaceous forests of California.
But not only that, let freedom ring from the snow mountains of Georgia. Let freedom ring from the lookout mountains of Tennessee.
Let freedom ring from every hill and molehill of Mississippi. From every mountainside, let freedom ring.
And when this happens, when we allow freedom to ring, when we let it ring from every village and every hamlet, from every state and every city, we will be able to speed up that day when all God's children will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old spiritual. Free at last, free at last, thank God Almighty, free at last.
Let's give our students a round of applause. I would now like to welcome the band again for their selection, Pray For Me. Now we will have our acknowledgments by Naya Evans.
Mia.
Mia Evans.
Yeah, Mia!
Yeah.
this time, we would like to recognize all visitors in the audience, parents, community members, board members, or district personnel. Please stand so that we may acknowledge your presence. Ms. April Lane for monitoring and receiving the base responses for each question contest. Mr. Frank Moses and his cafeteria staff members for Black History Lunch. Ms. Latricia Brown and Ms. Barbara Layman for assisting with gifts. Ms. Kimberly Blake for printing programs. We would also like to thank Mr. Roger Williams, Ms. Sarah Holliday, Benny Robert, Shane Shannon, and First Sergeant Troy James, and their students for providing for participating this afternoon, and Mr. John Hillian for his continued support and assistance with the use of the pad. Thank you.
At this time, Mr. Sword and Caroline Alvarez will present our speakers with a token of appreciation for their time and sharing their experiences with us.
Thank Ms. Hampton. She spent many hours preparing